up. Stimmen aus Südasien.
Speak up. Voices from South Asia.
Welcome to the Speak Up project and to our discussion on feminisms in South Asia. My name is Christa Wichterich. I'm a member of the Speak Up editorial network of the Stiftung Asienhaus and the Südasien Bureau. Today, Kalpana Sharma is with me, is our guest. She is a leading independent Indian journalist and one of the first and most prominent feminist journalists in the subcontinent. She covered gendered issues in a column called The Other Half from 1985 to 2016 in the Indian Express and the Hindu. And one focus throughout this long period was on violence against women. In 2019, she published a book with the title The Silence and the Storm: Narratives of Violence Against Women in India. Kalpana, can you please explain a bit the title of your book? What are the main changes in the narratives of violence against women in India in the past 40 years?
I'm very happy to be speaking to you, Christa, and talking on this subject, which remains relevant as always. You know, I chose that title, The Silence and the Storm, because it struck me in these 35 years that I've been writing on gender and women's issues in India, that there are certain issues on which there is a storm. You know, people take note, the media takes note, people come out and demonstrate, demand that the government does something. But the reality is the majority of the instances of violence against women are actually behind closed doors. This has been recorded, and also the whole violence of our developmental policy and environmental policies that actually put poor women particularly in a much worse situation. And nobody thinks of that as violence, you know. So that is why I chose that title, because this is something that has really struck me from the late 70s up to the present day, that how selective we are in our outrage on violence against women, and how we choose really to ignore the larger questions of violence that women live with every single day of the year. I mean, not just in India, I would say around the world, but in India particularly. There are two or three things in the process of writing the book, actually, because it helped me to look back and assess what has been happening. There are two or three things that struck me. In the late 70s and the early 80s, the Indian women's movement and actually a lot of social movements, I think, still had faith somehow that the state could deliver, you know. So there were demands for changes in the law, for instance, on rape, on the whole issue of dowry, for which in the 80s there were instances where women had been burnt alive because they had not brought enough dowry into their marital homes. There was also recognition in those days that you had to locate the struggle for women's rights within the larger economic and political situation in our country. It couldn't be apart from it. And as a result, there were large solidarities that were built, you know, with trade unions, with women from marginalized, I mean, groups that were organizing women from marginalized classes. So it was not just an urban, middle class, elitist concern. And I think that was its strength, the fact that, you know, there was not one women's movement, that there were many movements that came together on issues, and they saw it as an intervention on both economic policy, political aspects of the way our country is run, and legal. You know, all these three things came together, and latterly also media and the way in which women are portrayed in the media. That became part of the conversation in the 80s. I noticed a shift in both the media and in a way in the women's movement in the 90s when India went in for liberalization. You know, before that, we had had a sort of not really a socialistic economy, but a controlled economy. You know, there were many controls that the government had on private enterprise. In the 90s, it began opening up. And that is when media also thought of themselves more as profit centers rather than, you know, what we as older journalists had come into the media thinking that media's job was to report everything, hold the government accountable, etc. This was now a pure profit-centered approach to the media. And I think consumerism also turned a lot of people inwards, you know. It became a much more me thing rather than an us thing. And I think unwittingly that may have also affected the women's movement, because I think what happened was, even though there were still women's groups that were working on the issues that I spoke about in the 70s and the 80s, increasingly it became much more diversified and much less of this kind of broader coalitions coming together. So, there were still one or two big issues on which women did come together, and one of them was always violence, you know. In 2012, when this 23-year-old woman was gang-raped in Delhi, in our national capital, in a bus, that really brought people out, and especially younger women and men came out, and they were just appalled, because I think in urban areas, this is something that really hit a lot of women. But again, even that, you know, hid the reality that this is something that Dalit women, Dalit are the lowest caste, what were formerly called untouchable. They go through this all the time, and we in the media never report it. There are no demonstrations demanding justice for these victims. And these are stories that are there all around us. And yet, when it happens in a city, especially in the national capital, everybody is out, you know, demanding change, and everybody comes together. So the point I'm trying to make is, I think the nature of economy and the nature of our politics, which, by the way, also over this period has become much more divisive, much more centered on religion, on caste, not class so much. I think all that has permeated many social movements also, and in a way diluted their effectiveness when it comes to demanding the bigger changes, which I believe has to be in the whole mindset, you know, it's a big word to use, patriarchy, but literally in dismantling patriarchy, which has many sides to it, you know. So I think that somehow I personally feel, I mean, there are other women who may disagree with me, but I personally feel that somehow has been lost a little bit in India.
Yeah, but which relevance has the topic of violence against women for the new feminism or young feminists?
Yeah, so I think the younger feminists have, you know, apart from rape, which obviously because of the Delhi rape case, it brought a lot of young women out, because I think the public space is so threatening for women, and it's so controlling, because you have to literally decide what you're going to wear, what time you're going to go out, what time you're going to come back, you know, irrespective of the pressures you face anyway when you're at home. Even if you're an independent woman, you have to constantly negotiate these realities because there's a threat out there. But I think the other thing was, which was a very important development, was, you know, sexual harassment. Again, people like of my generation, we just put up with a lot of nonsense at work, you know, kind of remarks made and, you know, the obvious ways in which our bosses or the men who held power use that fact with women, and particularly with younger women. But now I think the good thing is the young women today are not willing to take it. So I think the response that the Me Too movement got in India, and the way in which that has continued to have an impact, where sexual harassment has also been recognized as a form of violence. And the other thing they're all speaking up about is, you know, with technology and access to social media, the kind of violence that women face when they speak out on social media, including rape threats and all kinds of things, is another thing that, you know, in our time, there was no social media. So I think these are new forms of violence that women experience, and they're speaking out about it as young women. And I think they're building solidarities wherever they are, which is a good thing. And they're doing it in creative ways, many of them, which is, again, a very important thing. So I think there has to be a coming together of the two perspectives, because I do believe even as you fight for your right not to be harassed at work, you have to recognize that women of the marginalized classes, of the lower classes, have no choice. You know, they're living through this. So as women who believe in a just society and a gender just society, we have to put an equal passion in trying to change these conditions in our society that allow so many millions of people and so many millions of women to live at this level of poverty and face the kind of violence and harassment they do. I mean, I feel that needs to be as much part of our passion. And I think it is now. I'm beginning to see a real change in the new generation of feminists who are coming in, who are taking in larger issues, political issues, coming out on the street, fighting on this against the Citizenship Act, for instance, which is a new act brought in by the Narendra Modi government, which will exclude Muslims. But it's much of the agitation has been led by women, and many of them younger women who never came out before. You know, so I think these things are changing.
Yeah. Let me come to the Me Too campaign. It came from outside, but it was picked up in India very much. Can you tell us a little bit about the influence and the specific forms in India of the Me Too campaign and the influence it had on the issue of violence against women and on this young feminism as well?
Well, as you say, it did come in from outside. And in the beginning, I think there was a lot of uncertainty about what this was all about, because there was a, you know, the name and shame campaign where women began to speak out and they got courage from other women speaking out. And many of the men they were mentioning were prominent men, some of them leading journalists. But we do have a law, we have a sexual harassment law, but none of them felt that they wanted to take this further and actually file a case, because I think there's no belief that the law can actually work, you know. In our criminal justice system is really broken in this country. It doesn't serve the interests of the poor. It certainly doesn't serve the interests of women. And I think many younger women who felt passionately about it didn't have the confidence to go ahead and actually file cases, you know. So they spoke about it anonymously on the internet. And this helped, but it also undercut the validity of what they were saying, because people kept saying, well, why don't they just come out? You know, but I think they were in a situation of no power. So, you know, I think they felt that if they came out, they would be worse off because there was no remedy. But a few women did come out, and especially against one of the leading editors, whose name is MJ Akbar, and who was the editor of a newspaper called The Asian Age. And finally, some of these women actually wrote specifically about what went on, you know, in the newsroom of The Asian Age. And I think that finally was a point where nobody could argue against the reality. And whether this has actually changed the culture, I don't know. It's hard to tell at the moment. But I would say amongst the educated younger men, particularly in urban areas, I think they've been put, on notice, you know. So I gather from other women now in the workplace that they are far more careful now, you know, because they know. Unfortunately, all this happened in 2018 and 2019. And then now we've had this pandemic and people are working from home. So let's see when things, so to speak, get back to normal and women start going back to work. And then let us see what happens. But it has been an interesting development. And I, as I said, now, you know, what I like about the younger women is that they're just not prepared to take any nonsense, you know. I mean, I think we put up with just too much, you know, of our generation. Yeah. And we didn't have a word for it. We didn't think of it as sexual harassment, you know. But yeah. I think they know what it is, and they are not going to stand up for it, you know, and they're going to speak out and build solidarities with other women in the workplace. Women journalists, for instance, now we have a network of women in media. In India, which is a big one, with more than 600 women journalists in 2002. And we felt there was a need for women journalists to have their own association. So rather than a formal association, we formed a network, which allows people to have ownership of the network. You know, so it's not this formal hierarchical structure of somebody who's chair and who's president and secretary. We decided each unit can decide themselves, as long as we agree to certain broad principles that we are all committed to. Mm-hmm. And it's been fantastic. You know, it's been a network that has grown. And whenever there is an instance of sexual harassment where a woman journalist needs support, the network has come to their support, has found lawyers who will help the woman in case she wants to file a case, have got it written about, have used social media to talk about it. So I think those kinds of things do work, even if the law is weak and doesn't necessarily deliver. I think we have to find these other ways of dealing with it. And it has to become a talking point. You know, it has to be something that people shouldn't be ashamed of or embarrassed to talk about. It should be something that's out there and spoken of.
Yeah, thank you very much, Kalpo. It was very nice to get these insights from you. With such a long history of reporting and working as a journalist on these issues and covering it even in a book. Thank you very much.
Speak Up. Eine Produktion des Redaktionsnetzwerks Südasien.
Speak Up, a production by the Editorial Network South Asia.